the draft from the copter swirls the deadly spray downward, smothering every inch of every twig.
Kia ora, good evening, I'm Melanie Reid. Tonight I'm bringing you the result of a year-long investigation into one of the most toxic chemicals known to mankind. That chemical was in a herbicide that was spread all over this country by the truck, train and plane load.
For almost a quarter of a century, 245T has been the New Zealand farmer's principal weapon against gorse.
But there was a problem, a big problem.
There's a lot of people sick here, a lot of people. But there's a lot of people around that area that are dead.
Parents suspecting links to 245T and their babies' birth defects were writing to the health department from districts all over New Zealand.
We're a breed of mutants that have been hidden.
Do you understand why people think there's just been one heck of a cover-up when it comes to dioxin, Paritutu, 245T, Ivan Watkins Dow?
Oh, I can absolutely understand the concern that it's been taking so long, there's been all these different studies.
Let Us Spray, a 90-minute special documentary after the break. For decades, the herbicides 245T and 24D were made in New Plymouth and sprayed all over New Zealand. And for decades, many New Zealanders have blamed the dioxin contained in these chemicals for deaths, illnesses and birth defects. Successive government reports have said there's not enough evidence to make a direct link. But that hasn't washed with many people, especially those who lived near the Ivan Watkins Dow manufacturing plant. They have talked of a cover-up, one of the biggest cover-ups in New Zealand's history. Over a year ago, we began talking to these people, to families who believe they've suffered from exposure to 245T and 24D. Their views and their personal struggles are at the heart of this story.
Well, it stuffed me, full stop. You know, it shagged my business developing. My health's been ratchet all the way along. I think probably it's buggered my marriages. Now it's gone on to my kids. My parents' father died early. My mother died early. My brother died. It's just everyone. It's just
Gary Hooper believes his family is typical of hundreds who have been poisoned and ignored. They all have something in common. They lived or worked in or near the Ivan Watkins Dow chemical plant in New Plymouth, or they were in direct contact with the agricultural chemicals 245T or 24D.
There's a lot of people sick here. A lot of people, but there's a lot of people around that area that are dead, you know, my age, younger.
Gary Hooper now lives in Whangarei, but he spent most of his life in New Plymouth. His parents built a house in the early 60s in the new subdivision of Paritutu. At around the same time, the Ivan Watkins herbicide plant also moved to Paritutu, near the coastline, a K or so away from the Hooper's new house.
I'd take a deep breath as a kid, I'd be probably 12 years old, and say, that Ivan Watkins smells good, you know.
As a young man, Gary Hooper worked across the road from the plant and would later work directly with the herbicide 24D. At 28 years old, he literally woke up paralysed and has suffered the effects of a peripheral nervous disorder ever since.
If people aren't affected by it, they don't kind of believe it, and the people that should be believing it, well, they're just turning a blind eye to it.
I have lost one of our children, which I put down to 24D, being That's something you really don't like talking about.
Bill French's son Scott survived for 10 days. He was born with no esophagus and Down syndrome. Bill now lives in the Coromandel, but he used to live in New Plymouth. His job, emptying bags of the herbicide 2,4-D into fertiliser. He has holes in his intestine, an enlarged heart and skin cancers. But his health is the least of his worries.
I have a daughter that's quite badly affected with cancer with it.
But how old is she?
She's 38. And another one's lost a lung.
Six of his grandchildren also have illnesses or deformities.
But it just seems to go on and on in the family. It's
You also lost your wife?
Yeah.
Do you feel like it's wrecked your whole life, Bill?
Yep. I'm not the only poor bugger. There's other poor buggers out there as well. My problem's only probably minor compared to some of the others. At least I can still get around.
Eyesight's gone, loss of legs, limbs and whatever, deteriorating all the time. And it probably won't be long before my speech will go too.
Roy Drake is 56. He believes his multiple sclerosis is a result of growing up by the Ivan Watkins Dow plant and working most of his life in or near the place.
How would you sum up the effect it's had on your life?
It's wrecked it completely. I might as well be dead.
But the big problem facing these people was, how do you prove your illness, disease or birth defects are linked to dioxin contamination from the Ivan Watkins Dow plant 245T or 24D? The first step is a blood serum test to find out if you have elevated levels of dioxin residues in your system. The catch is these tests are specialised and expensive and not routinely available through our Ministry of Health. So for most people, a serum test is out of the question. It all adds up to a demoralising equation to those convinced their lives have been destroyed.
What I want is the people of New Zealand and New Plymouth to understand that dioxin poisoning is real, it really has happened, and there are real, innocent, good people who have been exposed to a wicked chemical which has now debilitated or killed them.
50-year-old Gary Green is a Kiwi living in Perth. He has proof he's been poisoned. The Australian medical system paid for his blood serum tests. His level of dioxins were around six times what they should be.
It's a horrific chemical that enters your body without you knowing about it and begins to slowly deteriorate every system and attack it. For me, it's attacked my endocrine system, it's attacked my gastric system, it attacks your immune system. My immune system is shot, it doesn't work. I mean, I've got sores that don't heal.
So Gary, it almost sounds like you're stuffed.
Yeah, I mean, basically you could say I'm a more doodah than you can poke a stick at when it comes to my health.
In the mid-80s, Gary came to New Plymouth and worked here at a company called Steel & Tube. Just over the way, Ivan Watkins Dow were producing 245T and 24D.
It is hard, though, to comprehend, because what you're saying is that you got hit with something that you didn't see 20 years ago.
That's right.
When you were working here in New Plymouth.
Absolutely.
And you've gone on and had your life, and now you've got an illness so far down the track?
Yes, that's right. That's the insidious nature of this this chemical is that it doesn't give you an immediate response. It just gets inside you and begins to do its nasty work to the point it gets bit by bit until it actually gains control or overtakes. It's like as if it short circuits everything and everything just does not work properly. You know, and it's just like as if it's a virus that's been sent to undo you.
It's a human rights issue. These people have had their DNA blown apart by that plant.
For more than a decade, Andrew Gordon Gibbs has been an advocate for people who believe they've been poisoned by the Ivan Watkins Dow plant.
And the ironic thing, I think, is that many of them don't want to sue. All they want is healthcare and recognition. This would probably cost less than what our government spent covering it up over the years.
It was the mid-60s when the Midland, Michigan branch of chemical giant Dow US bought into the locally owned Ivan Watkins plant in New Plymouth. It was renamed Ivan Watkins Dow. As we know, a large portion of their business was producing the agricultural chemicals 245T and 24D. Separately, they were known as herbicides. Mixed together, they were known as Agent Orange. In the Vietnam War, the US Defense Force sprayed 44 million litres of Agent Orange, 245T and 24D. In comparison, New Zealand used an estimated 20 million litres. Kiwis considered the herbicides an agricultural wonder product.
Air spraying thistles, for instance, costs just one-fifth of a ground spraying job.
Used from Kaitaia to Bluff, nearly 200,000 acres a year of rough country was being cleared. And that's just from the air.
One of these flying pack horses can do the work of 200 men, if you could find 200 men.
But there was a problem, a big problem. These herbicides contained an unwanted byproduct, a dioxin contaminant, which many scientists believe can mutate genes, damage DNA, and be passed down through generations of families. Our Ministry of Health says claims of multi-generational effects aren't widely accepted scientifically. But Andrew Gordon Gibbs says the ministry should just take a look at families who lived in Paritutu when the plant was in full swing.
Many of them have three generations of health problems. Many of them have lost multiple people in one family. And most of them have moved away. A lot of them no longer live here.
It's often said, look, that was then and this is now.
Well, I think the big thing is here, when you have people passing away in their teens from a range of ailments that lived here back then, if you're one of those families, it's very much now.
I think that the system would like to delay and stall and evade the reality of this issue till it all passed away. That's a cheaper option, I'm sure.
From 1965 until 1971, a matron at the West Town Maternity Hospital in New Plymouth started seeing deformities at a rate she had never seen before in 29 years of maternity work. Again, we warn you, the following pictures are extremely disturbing. So alarmed at the extent and severity of the deformities, the matron meticulously began recording the evidence over 6 years, collating statistics, having each baby photographed. The horrendous deformities turning up in New Plymouth mirrored those in Vietnam, where 245T and 24D were being mixed together as Agent Orange and used in warfare. From the mid-60s to early 70s, New Plymouth, home of the Ivan Watkins Dow factory, had the highest birth defects in New Zealand. But by now, birth defects nationwide had doubled and in some cases tripled. Health officials said the increase was due to better reporting in maternity hospitals. It was never suggested, not publicly anyway, that the dramatic increase in birth defects nationwide coincided with New Zealand's heaviest exposure to deadly dioxin contaminants from agrochemicals. The New Plymouth matron says she gave the findings of her study of over 5,000 babies to what is now the Ministry of Health. They say they have never received it. Whatever the case, it wouldn't see the light of day for 30 years, when it was finally reviewed by Taranaki Health. At New Plymouth Maternity Hospital, it was found neural tube birth defects in babies from Paritutu were 3.5 times the national level, but concluded it was not statistically significant. Back at the time of the matron's concerns, though, parents of deformed babies were told the cause was anything from their genetics being mismatched to it being an act of God.
When he was born, the nurse that was with our doctor, when they couldn't get the tube into his tummy, the nurse turned around and said, "Good God, not another one," just like that. And they operated on him several times to try and fix the problem, but it must have been just too much for him.
And your son?
He was born with a cleft palate, and the other one started developing early, precocious puberty, they call it.
So what if you had the opportunity to be in the Ivan Watkins Dow boardroom?
Ivan Watkins boardroom? You'd have to hold me down, I think. Yeah. You'd have to hold me down because I'd have a drum of drench and drench every one of them with neat 24D or 245T. Take that. Now fix your problem, because that's what the government, the doctors, the hospitals, everyone's told us over the years. There's nothing wrong with us, you know.
I think you just got to die. And then they probably still won't believe you, so.
Do you feel guilty?
With the children, what I did, yeah, I do. Yep. Some of my kids have told me that if I didn't work with the bloody stuff, they wouldn't have those problems that they've got today, so. You know, I just find it hard to explain how to put all this. It's affected me, and that's all I can say.
And your kids?
And my children.
And your wife?
And my wife, yeah. Which is pretty hard to swallow over all these years. And things just get worse and worse as it goes down the track.
Coming up next, did those in authority know that these herbicides could potentially poison generations of Kiwi families? And if they did, why didn't they tell us? Day, Ivan Watkins Dow was big business and the state was right behind it. In 1969, the government introduced subsidies for agrochemicals in an effort to increase farm productivity. And Ivan Watkins Dow would have been well pleased. More than 100 of its products benefited from these taxpayer handouts. But that's not all. As questions slowly began to emerge about the safety of chemicals such as 245T, government officials stepped in to help out. They reassured the public and publicly backed the company.
skimming round the hillside, leaving a trail of potential fertility.
For almost a quarter of a century, 245T has been the New Zealand farmer's principal weapon against gorse.
While publicly Ivan Watkins Dow may have been enjoying the bonanza that went with government subsidies, they had a serious problem. Their 245T herbicide contained dioxin, one of the most toxic chemicals known to mankind. What did they do? They quietly withdrew 245T from the Kiwi home gardening market and didn't tell the public why. In 1970, they wrote to the government's Agricultural Chemicals Board.
Our company's policy is for gradual withdrawal of 245T from these markets without publicity. We assume the board would see it prudent not to publicise the withdrawal.
So this was done very much behind closed doors?
Yep, absolutely.
Bruce Wildblood Crawford has spent the last 4 years researching his PhD on the impact of 245T and dioxin in New Zealand.
If they admit any sort of fallibility, then they are generating suspicion of their products. If they said that it shouldn't be used around the home, then people would start to suspect whether it should be used at all.
Dow US, the American partner of Ivan Watkins Dow, had been in the know for years that 245T was potentially dangerous, as this internal memo from 1965 showed.
This material is exceptionally toxic. It has tremendous potential for producing core acne and systemic injury. I'm particularly concerned with persons using the material on a daily, repeated basis.
So by the mid-60s, they knew?
They certainly knew that dioxin existed. They knew that it was very, very hazardous, and they knew essentially how it was being produced. Yep.
You would have thought they might have said something.
It seemed to be an issue that the companies figured out on their own and then largely kept in-house.
So you could say they covered it up.
I think that they certainly tried to keep it very, very quiet.
We're waging the war from the air. The days of the gorse and thistles are numbered.
In the mid-60s, 245T had been in heavy use in this country for nearly 20 years, with little or no concern about the mutagenic dioxin compound.
The draft from the copter swirls the deadly spray downward, smothering every inch of every twig.
New Zealand had one of the highest rates of 245T use per capita in the world. It was being applied by the chopper and plane load from Bluff to the Cape to clear land and wipe out the likes of gorse and broom. And by and large, it all came from the Ivan Watkins Dow plant in the new Plymouth suburb of Paritutu.
There's numerous anecdotal stories of people's curtains melting, clothes being stained when they're hanging out to dry, people walking across lawns and leaving dead footprints because they'd had chemicals on their feet from working at the plant. And there were also many, many letters sent to government in the mid-60s. People that lived around there complaining that the smell crawled over us. The controls that they used for air pollution during that period were very, very rudimentary. So,
almost non-existent.
Yeah, yep, you could probably argue almost non-existent, yeah.
The New Zealand government must have known by now, though, that they had a very big problem on their hands.
Yeah, I mean, certainly the government by the early 70s and by 71 knew that dioxin was mutagenic, possibly, and definitely iatrogenic, causing birth defects. But the argument that came out, in particular from Dow Chemical, was that it was only at a certain dose. So as long as you kept dioxin at a small enough level, then those things weren't a problem.
Dioxin is so toxic, it's measured in parts per million or trillion. So the levels are fundamental to the whole 245T story. The higher the dioxin content, the worse the health and environmental effects. Our levels prior to 1973, according to Ivan Watkins Dow and New Zealand authorities, were one part per million.
incredibly high by today's standards, but that one part per million claim is far from reliable. Firstly, in the early days, rabbits' ears were used to measure levels of dioxin. Hardly an accurate recording device.
They would just swab it onto their ear and then look for certain reactions.
See if they blistered.
Yeah, blistered and, yep.
Not exactly CSI. Secondly, internal memos from Dow US we've obtained show they were buying a German formula to get the dioxin levels down to under 10 parts per million in the mid-60s. What's more, this letter from longtime Ivan Watkins Dow chief chemist Arnold Ratislav says at that time the mix was contaminated between 2 and up to over 20 parts per million. So you have to ask how on this official table the 1 part per million column has been arrived at.
The idea that it was just 1 part per million is a bit of a relic. It's a falsehood that still, unfortunately, is still widely used in a lot of government reports. The government still cites 1 part per million as the standard dioxin content of 2,4,5-T going back into the 40s, and that's just utterly not true.
It wasn't until the early 70s that Ivan Watkins Dow could genuinely say 2,4,5-T had been cleaned up, so to speak. In 1971, Ivan Watkins Dow wrote to our Department of Health assuring them 2,4,5-T was safe in its current form.
Consistently contains less than 1 part per million of the mutagenic dioxin compound.
So by the early 70s, Ivan Watkins Dow itself was talking about a mutagenic dioxin compound. In America, 2,4,5-T had been banned in all populated areas and waterways, following studies confirming it caused birth defects in animals. In Vietnam, the US had stopped spraying Agent Orange because of suspicion it caused birth abnormalities in humans. But here, in the land of the long white cloud, 2,4,5-T had landed a heavy government subsidy, halving the price, and with that, sales boomed. At the same time, parents suspecting links to 2,4,5-T and their babies' birth defects were writing to the health department from districts all over New Zealand. 18 cases of babies with deformities, plus 6 cases in animals, would be investigated throughout 1972 by an inquiry team convened not by the Department of Health, but by the Agricultural Chemicals Board.
The board has felt that with the
They concluded there was no link between 2,4,5-T and birth defects.
One of the really telling things was that they defined exposure in a very, very narrow way. Unless it was tasted in the water or the mother had been directly, around spraying, they discounted exposure. So if she lived in an area where aerial spraying had occurred, that wasn't considered good enough exposure. If her husband came home from work with his clothes soaked in 2,4,5-T, that wasn't considered good enough exposure. So they basically discounted a lot of potential birth defects on that basis.
The inquiry team would eventually regulate a tenfold drop in the permissible level of dioxin in 2,4,5-T from 1 part per million to the then safe level of 0.1 part per million. But the cases kept coming. In the small Taranaki town of Opanaki, 4 anencephalic fetuses were reported, babies born without a brain. What made it remarkable is that 3 came from the same street. The medical officer of health was called in to investigate.
So, what conclusion did you reach?
He's just an active guy.
Then, over in the Waikato, between December 1975 and January 76, 8 cases of neural tube defects, spina bifida or anencephaly, in just 1 month. That's 8 times the expected national average. And in Northland, 8 more cases of birth defects, babies born with neural tube defects.
Why is it that evidence of small-scale epidemics of this and other related deformities is not the subject of prompt and positive investigation by New Zealand authorities?
A 1977 TV program turned the issue into a major public debate.
Big business has pushed this product onto the market.
And there has never been a case proved against it.
Who is an expert in weighing up human cripplings against so much gorse killed?
In response to the program, an investigating committee was promised. Privately, though, a confidential memo from the Minister of Health to all members of Cabinet reads:
the sole justification for the proposed committee is to allay public fears that 245T, when used as a spray to control weeds, is responsible for abnormalities such as spina bifida.
And there is some indication that essentially they just began to be, I think, more focused on managing the issue as a public relations issue than they were as a scientific issue, and that was beginning to overtake the Department of Health. It's very clear in lots of letters at a very high level saying we need to look into this dioxin thing, but we also need to remember how important 245T is for our economy.
Behind the scenes, the Agricultural Chemicals Board was lobbying the government.
Anyone with a deformed child has grasped at this straw and blamed 245T. To spend further time and money on investigating alleged links with spina bifida is, in my view, unjustified waste.
And the thing is a lot of those mothers might not have, they suspected it. So they said, hey, we think this might have caused the deformity. Can you look into it? And I think that that's the injustice in that the Department of Health didn't look into it enough.
Why do you think that was?
They relied on the chemical industry for the information and for the guidance on how to do this, and they didn't take leadership and really ask good hard questions and demand good answers. They just said, how can we manage this issue so that we can continue to use this product that's very valuable for the economy?
Meantime, across the other side of the world in America, Dow US was facing a $22 million court case over 245T. Who did they turn to? None other than the Kiwis, namely Professor McQueen, the consultant toxicologist to the New Zealand Department of Health, who had been the principal advisor in the birth defects inquiries. What's more, he got the all clear from the then Minister of Health to give evidence for Dow US. His proposed testimony was:
the New Zealand Department of Health remains firm in its belief that as presently used, 245T is not a health hazard.
I think it's remarkable that the Minister of Health actually allowed him to do that. It shows how intertwined the government and their advisors, which is what he was an advisor to the Department of Health, and the industry, how intertwined they are, particularly in managing the issue.
In 1983, the 4.5-year American court case over 245T came to an end, with Dow US pulling out. All licenses to produce 245T were cancelled in the US. Most countries followed suit. But here in God's own, it was business as usual. For years, government officials told the public there was nothing to worry about. 245T was safe, even though it contained a dioxin that was said to be capable of causing DNA damage, and even though parents up and down the country believed it caused birth defects or was responsible for the death of their babies. Now there was another factor. New Plymouth workers began to worry about what it was doing to them. In the early 80s, a group of men in the 245T, 24D production plant noticed there seemed to be an alarming number of workers dying of cancer. They asked the health department to look into it, which they did with the involvement of Ivan Watkins Dow. This is what the workers were told.
No conclusions could be drawn from the information provided, and that no useful purpose could be served by investigating the situation in depth.
Neil Hurdson, a former worker and union rep, didn't leave it there. For decades, he has kept track of 30 men who worked directly with 245T and 24D.
And today, I know personally that 14 of those people are dead. And many of those have died of cancer, the majority.
What sort of age were these men?
We've got one here at 32, what, 48, 54, age 43, 40, 40, 55, so...
Young.
Young.
Neil Hurdson's worries were well-founded. A study spanning 30 years would eventually show the cancer risk among 245T and 24D production workers was much higher than other New Zealanders. But back to Ivan Watkins Dow in the mid-80s. By now, they were the only factory in the world still making 245T, and the pressure really came on. But Ivan Watkins Dow had support from an unusual quarter, our very own Director of Public Health.
And we know full well that I myself, for example, provided it were properly boiled, could drink many litres of the ready-to-use 245T spray each day, and it would not affect my health.
So you would drink it?
I'm perfectly prepared to drink it.
Ivan Watkins Dow had more problems than public pressure. In 1986, a burst disc released dioxin at the 245T production plant. It was enough to tip the balance, and a ministerial inquiry was finally set up. The year-long investigation would conclude.
There is no evidence that the general populations is being exposed to 245T or the traces of dioxin contained in it.
Big call when they had not even done tests on the general population for traces of dioxin. Curiously though, the inquiry team did recommend what would be the third tenfold drop and the allowable dioxin levels. This made production virtually impossible, and the manufacturing of 245T finally stopped in 1987. But by now, New Zealand had gone down in history as the last place on Earth to have made it.
Not only were we the last country in the world to make 245T. We were also amongst the first to use it. It was first trialled in Taranaki in 1948.
Andrew Gordon Gibbs lost his sister to spina bifida and hydrocephaly.
Well, I think these people need healthcare and recognition. I've seen.
He's spent the last 15 years fighting to raise awareness about the damage done by agrochemicals in New Plymouth and throughout New Zealand.
I think what the public have had trouble getting their head around and understanding is that the dioxin from 245T contaminated New Zealand's food chain. And 85 to 95% of that contamination occurred in New Zealand before 1973.
Let's not forget, in those days, 245T was heavily contaminated with dioxin, and it was being sprayed from the Cape to the Bluff. This inevitably led to the nationwide contamination of the food chain. But it wasn't until the late 80s measurements of dioxin in humans were carried out. Levels in 245T sprayers were analysed. Samples were also taken from non-sprayers for a comparison group.
What they found was the levels in the sprayers were 15 times higher on average than they'd been predicted. But what was most interesting was in a matched group of men, the control group, who hadn't been near the end of a spray gun, they found levels just as high as some of the sprayers. This was proof at last that dioxin had gone through the food chain.
Evidence that New Zealanders had been exposed to dioxin through the food chain was strengthened by the nationwide testing of breast milk, which was part of a World Health Organization study. When it came to the dioxin from 245T, our levels were amongst the highest in the world. But oddly enough, on the international stage, a very different picture was portrayed.
The lowest levels were detected in India, New Zealand, and Thailand.
How could this be? Well, as chance would have it, it was the first two samples analysed that were sent to the World Health Organization, and they just happened to be, by far, two of the lowest of the 37 samples.
It may well have been a coincidence, but I find it interesting they declined to take part in the next WHO round of breast milk testing. I believe they were aware the longer they left it, the lower the levels would be.
Why is this so important? Well, having low levels of dioxin is a pretty big factor for a country like New Zealand, so heavily dependent on agricultural exports. Indeed, it would be 10 years, 1998, before more breast milk tests were done. Not surprisingly, levels had fallen. By now, it was more than a decade since 245T production had stopped, and nearly a quarter of a century since the peak exposure period. It was at this point our Ministry of Health embarked on an extensive nationwide study of dioxin levels. However, of the 1,834 blood serum tests done, none were taken from the residents of Paritutu. Again, the people with potentially the highest exposure were left out.
Their main strategy is delay tactics until you die. And they don't care.
By now, many New Plymouth people were well and truly fed up.
I believe that they should be nailed by the ass to the fence.
There was public meeting after public meeting, Vietnam veterans and politicians joining forces.
These governments, Labor and National, under past Labor and National Prime Ministers, and many of the people who still sit in the House today, have told New Zealand mistruths or, in the very best, have kept information from us.
We stand by everybody. We stand together to appoint this bloody government and tell them to accept their responsibility for what has gone wrong. We stand united. We shall not yield.
Down, down, down. Down, down, down.
What these people wanted was either genetic or serum tests, specifically for those who had lived or worked in Paritutu back when the contamination from Ivan Watkins Dow was at its worst. Finally, in February 2004, the first round of serum tests of Paritutu residents were taken. People who lived or had lived near the plant would have their exposure to dioxin from Ivan Watkins Dow determined once and for all.
The Acting Director of Public Health has a statutory responsibility for the health of all New Zealanders.
A team of health officials flew to New Plymouth from Wellington. With them, the results of round one of the long-promised serum tests.
Long-term residents who lived close to the Ivan Watkins Dow plant for more than 20 years between the years 1962 and 1987 do indeed have higher levels of dioxin in their blood than other people in New Zealand.
In fact, levels equivalent to areas of South Vietnam sprayed with Agent Orange.
To be more precise, the actual level that was found, the average in Paritutu, is 11 picograms per gram. In comparison, the expected national average was 3.5 picograms per gram. To have an approximately threefold elevation in the Paritutu community.
That's bad enough. The Paritutu community have three times the dioxin levels of average New Zealanders. But actually, it's much worse than that. The national average they've used is 7 years out of date, and this puts a bias on the results. Using the corrected national average of just over two, Paritutu people are not three times, but five times the national average. So the press and public were misinformed. You have to ask why they used outdated figures when their own documents warned them by doing this, and I quote, will give excessively high typical population levels.
Well, effectively, it suggests that the problem wasn't as great as it really was.
So you're creating a better impression?
Yes, yes.
Coming up next, round two of the Paritutu serum tests. We engage a forensic accountant to crunch the numbers. So you're saying that there's a possible omission, you're talking about inconsistencies, and the mixing of the data sets. People being in the wrong groups.
Yes. Yeah.
So the report, therefore, can't be considered reliable.
This part definitely can't be reliable. It isn't reliable.
People who had lived at Paritutu were desperate to find out some sort of proof that their health problems were caused by emissions from the Ivan Watkins Dow plant. Finally, there was evidence they'd been poisoned. They had levels of dioxin in their blood on par with people in Vietnam. But the blood serum studies weren't finished. They were waiting to see the results of a second round of testing. So the people of Paritutu pinned their hopes on the blood serum tests they thought would supply the answers they were so desperately looking for. They were told they would be comprehensive. There would be 100 blood samples taken. But by the time testing came around, the sample group was reduced to just 52. And by now, it was 17 years after the plant had stopped making 245T. Why did it take so long to do the serum tests in Paritutu?
I think there was a mixture of things. Firstly, the recognition that there was a clear link between exposure to dioxin and some cancers was really only formalised in 97, and so that gave another burst, if you like, to the issue and gave, you know, there was another reason to look again at the issue.
But the people in Paritutu, who are potentially one of the highest exposed groups, you know, the tests were recommended in 1986 by an environmental working party. The tests were...
Dr. Mark Jacobs is New Zealand's Director of Public Health.
You tested sprayers in 1988. Nationwide serum tests of nearly 2,000 people were done in 1997, and still the people of Paritutu are waiting. Is it any wonder that the people down there have a saying about the Ministry of Health, and it is, they will delay and deny until you die?
Look, I think it's entirely understandable that they're concerned about the delays, and as I say, I think it would have been much more preferable with the benefit
of
hindsight.
Why didn't it happen?
Yeah, I don't know, but I think part of it was because of the fact that there was still a lot of uncertainty around the science, you know, what the health implications were of exposure until the 97 identification. But with the benefit of hindsight, clearly the serum study should have happened earlier. Would have been much preferable for all sorts of reasons if it did.
Remember, round one of the serum tests showed Paritutu people had five times the dioxin levels of other New Zealanders. In round two, another 28 people were tested, making the final sample group 52.
Do you have any questions afterwards? If you want to arrange interviews, please come in.
In March 2005, the Ministry of Health released what would be the full and final report. This time, using the correct national background average, the final results showed Paritutu residents on average had four times the dioxin levels of other New Zealanders.
It's a concern that people were exposed at those sorts of levels, there's no doubt about that, and we're certainly very sympathetic for the people that were exposed in a way that they had no control over.
But the New Plymouth Dioxin Group and some of the test participants believe the serum study is seriously flawed. They claim the data has been wrongly interpreted, and this downplays the degree of the dioxin contamination problem.
What I understand they're saying is we don't know what the hell happened.
So we hired an independent expert to see if these concerns are warranted.
I think they are, yes.
John Leonard, a forensic accountant, studied the data we obtained along with the government's own documentation.
Your figures are quite a lot different to their figures. Your figures show this.
Mm-hmm.
Their figures are more like this.
That's correct, yes. That's because they've got two people in the wrong place. Now, if you take that...
In brief, John Leonard found there were participants in the wrong group. Different data sets merged, a potential omission of a key participant, and lack of certainty because of the reduced sample size.
What I'm saying is there is enough information for me to have concerns about the accuracy of it.
How concerned are you about the accuracy of it?
Academically, it is concerning. And I guess for the people in Paritutu, it would be emotionally very concerning.
So you don't think the people of Paritutu have been well served by this study?
No, I don't think they have. My recommendation would be that somebody totally independent looks at this. The data is there. Why not let somebody else look at it? If it's accurate, then fine. I'm wrong. But if it's not accurate, then we will find out the correct position. Doesn't matter who's wrong. The vital thing here is the correct position for the people of Paritutu.
Yeah, and if you've got that advice, we want to see it. I mean, if there's issues around the methodology, we want to know. I mean, that was why.
Well,
I'll
tell you what. Since October 2005, this has been sent to the Health and Disability Commissioner, the Minister of Health, the ESR study team. From people in the community. The issues have already been canvassed.
Well, I mean, I'm aware of issues like concerns being raised by different people in the community.
These exact issues have been raised by people in the community.
I mean, all we can do is go away and look again to see whether there's new issues that are being raised that haven't been dealt with previously.
We put to Dr. Jacobs the conclusion from our independent expert, John Leonard. His recommendations are that the serum study is reviewed with the raw data by an independent biostatistician, preferably someone offshore. Will you agree to this?
Well, certainly. In fact, we've already had the study and its methodology and its findings reviewed by a number of independent experts offshore.
Did they have the Appendix O? Did they have the raw data?
I think they got all of it, yes.
Well, I've asked them and they didn't. They didn't have Appendix O, which has got the anonymous serum results in it.
Well, I mean, my assumption is that they had received it. I mean,
we can
double check
that.
Well, I mean, I would have assumed that the independent reviewers would get access to the full report, so they can, you know, they can make a considered judgment on whether there's issues with the methodology.
There's issues with the data.
Well, that's
the advice
that's what I meant. It's included in the methodologies.
Any concerns over the serum studies could, of course, be clarified if the Ministry of Health were to release Appendix O, which contains the anonymous serum results. We have been asking for that document under the Official Information Act since March of this year.
We're still working through the appeal to the Ombudsman that you made to get access to
the anonymous.
Obviously, the Ombudsman and the Privacy Commissioner have looked at that. And so at the end of the day, after all of that process, if they indicate that, in fact, there aren't privacy concerns, then we'll release them.
Do you understand why people think this has been one heck of a cover-up when it comes to Dioxin, Paritutu, 245T, Ivan Watkins Dow?
Oh, I can absolutely understand the concern that it's been taking so long. There's been all these different studies that you know, have they shown things, haven't they shown things?
What has been clearly shown is that the Paritutu community were exposed to high levels of dioxin. In order to identify the effects of this exposure, the recommendation was to do a health study on people who lived in Paritutu when the plant was in full 245T production mode. That would mean focusing on around 500 houses in Paritutu, approximately 2,000 people. Instead, the Ministry of Health carried out a cancer study of the entire New Plymouth Territorial Authority, approximately 60 to 66,000 people. Any problems, elevations in Paritutu would be lost.
Yeah, I mean, you're absolutely right that if the issue was just about Paritutu, the ideal thing would have been to try and look at the cancer rates just in the people who've been in that area, you know, a kilometre south, 400 metres east.
That was the Minister of Health briefing. The Minister of Health briefing was for any scientific study to be valid, you had to identify the exposed group and you had to track them and you had to trace them.
Yeah, and
that was in 2001. That still hasn't been done.
A lot of it was practical issues around trying to identify that group because the local sort of census area, the boundaries had changed and trying to identify the people. But also really another practical issue around these sort of epidemiological studies is at the end of the day, if the numbers aren't very big, they don't tell you anything. At the end of the day, the ministry and myself as a member of the ministry, I mean, if there's an issue there, we want to find it. I mean, it's not in anybody's interest. It's not in our interest to say there isn't an issue.
It doesn't look like you want to find it. Because if you look at this issue over decades, you've got medical officers of health saying, oh, those birth defects are an act of God. You had the director of public health saying you could drink 245T. I mean, do you understand why affected people have felt that the health department has been more interested in protecting the New Zealand economy than protecting public health?
Oh, I can understand why people who've been exposed to something against their will are concerned about that, and they're concerned that people aren't taking action that they think needs to happen.
To me, she wasn't dead, like, the whole time. You know, to me, she was just a normal baby, and, you know, I held her and stuff like a normal baby. But, yeah.
Coming up next, the families who believe they are living with the legacy of the agrochemicals 245T and 24D. Your daughter has just buried her baby.
Yeah.
So that's four generations.
Yeah.
After all the reports, all the tests, all the studies, many families still don't believe they've been told the truth, still don't believe anyone has had a decent look for the answers. Many are convinced their illnesses have been caused by 245T or 24D. And worse than that, they believe those exposed to the chemicals have passed health problems down through the generations, to their children and grandchildren, and beyond.
I would say all of my children were exposed to it because I was taking it home on my overalls in the car. The wife was having to shake my overalls out to get it out before she put it into the washing machine.
Bill French featured in the earlier part of this program. He lost his wife, a child, and many of his other children have developed serious illnesses. So too have his grandkids. Bill brought his family up in New Plymouth. For many years, he worked directly with agrochemicals.
I can still smell the stuff. Only got to think about it and I can smell it.
Cherie is 38. She is the daughter of Bill French.
I've had different kinds of tumours. I've lost my spleen and nearly all of my pancreas now. I've had my spine operated on and had discs and things removed from another operation. And I've also had an operation on my groin from another...
Like her father, Cherie worries more about her children's health than her own.
My oldest has hearing and kidney problems. My one after that, she was born with defect in her legs. The next one was Hannah, and she has hearing problems. And then there was Joseph, who was born with cerebral palsy. You know, it's like if you knew, maybe then you wouldn't have children. Maybe you wouldn't. And there's no guarantees. No guarantees it's not going to happen to them. And the worst part is, for me, is... Oh, sorry. If I get sick, who's going to be there for them? No one will be left for them because everybody's sick. And just, I don't know, how do you tell them that you've given them something or made them sick? And my dad's lived with the same feeling. And until I got sick and my kids started getting sick, I didn't even understand that. And it makes it easier to understand why Dad feels like he does sometimes.
She was diagnosed with Down syndrome. Also, she had a major heart condition, which was...
Cherie's daughter, Laken. 4 months ago, she buried her baby, named Letitia.
It's put me off, like, it's, like, to get pregnant again, I'd be completely scared.
Letitia would have been the fourth generation of this family to have suffered illness or genetic defects. Father, daughter, granddaughter, great-granddaughter.
And how far is it going to keep going?
What do they say when you say it's because of my dad's working with chemicals?
They just say you can't prove it. How do you know? How, you know, it hasn't been proven, or... and it's like, how can something be proven when it's been hidden? Basically, that's what it is. You know, and that's why I said we're a breed of mutants that have been hidden.
There are many, many families who lived or worked in Paritutu who have similar stories.
I've been seeing the big picture. I've started to see the tree, and I'm seeing this person over here, and he's got four children, and three of them have got cancer, and his brother's got this and that. And you start putting that out there, and you think, man, when you get the big picture, it's horrific. But if you keep it fragmented, then it doesn't have the power. And I'm sure that those who don't want this to be seen understand that.
Gary Green, too, is fighting for his life and believes this plant is the reason why. Dow AgroSciences, as it is now called, declined to be part of this story. Instead, they referred us to their website and to government studies. But Gary Green has a message for them.
Stop avoiding this issue. Take responsibility. Pick up the baton and look after the message you've made and clean it up and take care of the people you've affected.
Why is the... So we asked Dr. Mark Jacobs, Director of Public Health, why recompense has never been sought from Dow.
Well, my understanding of that is that, and I mean, that was another question that clearly I had. I mean, everybody would have that question. We did get advice on that, and the advice was that as far as we can tell, that Dow were operating within the permissions that they were given at the time, and which then means that there isn't the capacity to try and seek that legal redress in that sort of formal sense.
Hey, so was the US Army in Vietnam.
Yeah, well, I mean, that's the advice that we've had, which is why...
The New Zealand taxpayer, that 245T was subsidised heavily, millions and millions and millions of dollars. The New Zealand taxpayer they have paid for it to be subsidised. They've paid for all these health studies, and now they're paying for health care. Why does Dow get off this scot-free?
I mean, that's not a closed book. If more information comes to light, I mean, we will continue to revisit that.
Will you pursue that? Because at the very least, Dow knew, they knew that it caused systemic injury. They knew what it did from 1965. This department knew what it did from 1971. Why are we paying?
Well, all I can say is that if we get more information, and we're very keen to receive any new information...
How much information do you want, Dr. Jacobs?
If we get information, good information that potentially could stand up in court, then we would really want to we would re-examine that whole issue.
Well, for a start off, this is wrong. They're saying that their product was contaminated with only one part per million from 1948 to 1972. That's been used by the Ministry of Health for years. That's wrong. That's completely flawed.
Well, I mean, I don't know whether that's right or not, but, I mean, if you have evidence of that, then please pass it on.
Outspoken chairman of Dow US Chemicals, C.A. Gerstacker, is frequently quoted as saying he dreamt of an island where multinational business could operate beholden to no nation or society. The big question is, did he find such an island? The story of the spraying of herbicides in New Zealand is a long one, and one thing's for sure, it's not over yet. If you have any information for us, or if you'd like to comment on tonight's program, our email is letusspray@tv3.co.nz. That's letusspray, all one word, at tv3.co.nz. Or you can write to us at letusspray, TV3 Private Bag, 92624 Simon Street, Auckland. That's letusspray, TV3 Private Bag, 92624 Simon Street, Auckland. And this documentary is available online at www.tv3.co.nz. That's tv3.co.nz. I'm Melanie Reed. Thanks for joining us. Good evening.